Thank you very much. So, well, I am going to speak about this prospective affair. So just a few words about prospective, I have to say something before. This work I am presenting is not only mine, but it is based on a work in progress, nearly completed, by my colleagues Fabienne Barato, Gilles Bilaine, Fabien Esculier, Josette Garnier, Sarah Lombroso, Caroline Petit, and Xavier Poux. And I think it is very important to mention them. And now I am going to the prospective affair. So I just wanted you to know where I am speaking from. For us, prospective is a kind of serious imagination as we speak about serious game. And it is a combination of determinism, something you can't change, like scientific laws. Well, you could change them, but we admit that they are true up to now. Chance and hazard, that is the power of imagination, and a kind of freedom, that because we are going to take kind of decisions in our prospective work. There is a specificity in French prospectives that is the territorial dimension that has been pushed by the French state since the 1960s. But most of this territorialized perspective doesn't take into account environment, climate change, and so on. And what we want to do in this work is to combine all this and have a reflection upon socio-ecological transition through territorial metabolism. This is done through a research program which is called PIRENSEN. It is a more than 30 years old research program that is funded by some institution, especially in the water domain. And that was at the beginning, logically, mainly interested in water issues and especially in modeling the water quality, for instance. And progressively, this program was interested in social sciences and especially in history in order to better understand how did water quality change through time, but also to have a view of the history of the basin and of society water relationships. It was a little more than 20 years ago that I joined this program for those historical aspects. And at one time we thought, well, now we know the past trajectory of the basin, what could happen in the future? And this for us was very important to discuss in order to open our mind upon those questions of society-nature relationships, but also to discuss with actors, stakeholders, in order to think about this future. This work was done step by step. First step, we went from nitrogen concern to agri-food systems concern. The nitrogen question in the Seine Basin is very important due to the presence of a huge city, Paris, urban area, and due to agriculture, so for water quality, nitrogen and nitrates, for instance, are major concerns. That's why we were very embedded in this nitrogen issue. And we moved from this question of nitrogen to the question of agri-food system. And we wanted to test the change of the effect of the change of the agri-food system upon water quality and nitrogen circulation. And so in the first stage, and it was led by Gilles Bilaine, there were two scenarios that were examined. The first was, let's say, diet and agriculture more than as usual, the scenario ouvert spécialisé, globalized, specialized. And the second one was a demitarian diet, so that is a twice less animal protein in the diet, and integrated organic crop livestock farming, what we call scénario autonome reconnecté demitarien. What you see on the images is above, this is the present day situation of nitrogen circulation in order to feed Paris inhabitants. And you see that it is a globalized circulation with nitrogen coming from South America, nitrogen coming from synthetic fertilizers. And this is the situation with the Demeterian organic scenario, with only nitrogen fixation, less leaching of nitrogen. And also what was very important for us is that you see that we can export food even in this scenario. So this first result was very important for us because it demonstrated that on a biogeochemical point of view, it was possible to change. And it was an answer to those who say, no, you can't do anything with organic agriculture and so on. But this was not enough, and we step by step, we went from this thinking of agri-food system transformation to the socio-ecological transformation of the basin. First, it seemed important to connect this to urban issues. It was a major concern for me, as I am an urban planner and interested in urban topics, because I told my colleague that if agriculture change, of course, cities should change also. You can't have organic farming and cities as they are now. The second thing was, and it was something that we really had to discuss a lot, was that those major changes that we were anticipating could only occur if the political and economic system itself is transformed. That's why we enriched our two scenarios. And the first one, the ouvert spécialisé, with diet and agriculture as usual, became Paris, the new London. I will explain this in a few moments. Let's say a neoliberal scenario. And the second one, this one with a Demeterian diet and organic farming, became les villes en leur bassin, cities in the basin or in the interland. But we went further because we see, and everybody here sees, that there are some weak signals that some people express the need for more radical changes. And among us, some are engaged in politically engaged in those this expression of this need and of a change in society nature interactions and in society organization. And our third scenario is called post-metropolization, so it is a post-metropolitan scenario, and we will see that it is a bioregional municipalist scenario. And last but not least, we decided to take into account energy, because we are really focused on food, on urban issues, territorial issues, and energy was really lacking, and we added this lately. How did we do this, and how is the time going? It is going. we are an interdisciplinary group of researchers, we know each other quite well, that makes easier to discuss, and we really speak with, we are equal, when we speak of nitrogen, we are equal to those who speak of municipalism and so on. So, very interdisciplinary group. We had the support of three student studios, we have the name of the students here. Those studios are conducted within the master urban planning of my university. And this is a huge work because students work for full-time for 4 months, so each group. And they really help us because they are fantastic. And this work is regularly discussed with and transformed with the institutional partners of the PIRENSEN and other experts or researchers. And so we have a kind of incremental discussion. And what you see here is this is this result with 5 booklets. You can find them on the website of the Pirensen. This is what Xavier Poux calls the basis. This is the basis of the prospective reflection. That is an inquiry of what is today the Seine Basin and what have been its last transformation since, let's say, 50 years. So it helps us to engage in the future. This is a result of a workshop with experts and actors of the basin. And here, excuse me, you have the first, the two-thirds scenarios. With here, this is the booklet of the scenario itself, and here a longer booklet, which is all the justifications of the scenario. That means that we don't just imagine things. We had to do numerous interviews, workshops, field trips, and so on to produce the scenario. And this is for the last one, the post-metropolitan scenario. First of all, when we, not first of all, but one thing you have to do for the scenarization is to imagine a trajectory. We know where we want to go. I have said the Paris, le Nouveau Londres, les villes en leur bassin, post-métropolisation, but we have to think about how are we going there. You see that this is not the same representation here. These are the two-third scenarios and the third, because it was a different group of students and we didn't want to impose them to use the same convention than the first, because it was a little annoying for them. So we asked them to imagine their own representation. And now we are going to put all this together. But for the three scenarios, what we thought, that crisis would be an important thing. Because crisis will occur. I must say that the first two were imagined before the sanitary crisis, but we had sanitary crisis in the scenario. We imagined that there would be some climate problems and catastrophes, storms and so on, floods, and blah, 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 etc. And also, mostly in the third scenario, social crisis that would push social contestations and so on. But the results are different, because in the first case, Paris, le Nouveau Londres, Paris takes the place of London after the Brexit. So it initiates this neoliberal trajectory. In the second case, Paris does not become the new London, because it is Frankfurt. And so it is a little weakened in economical term and political term. And also, at the same time, we imagine that there are some food scandals and so on, and that what we call the corps intermédiaire, that is NGOs and so on, are winning some conflicts upon great companies that are using pesticides or things like that. All these awful things. And this engages the society in quite a transformation and the victory of an eco-socialist government after 1932. And for the last one, we added to those crises I have mentioned, the social crisis like Gilets Jaunes, but more important, but also some collapses in electricity networks, internet, and so on, that fragilize the dominant system and that lead progressively, I could explain how, to a transformation through bioregionalism, municipalism, and finally a nearly no state situation in France, not only in the Seine Basin. And we imagine that it could be in Europe, all around Europe. So here, what you can see are the main characteristics of the three scenarios. I have forgotten to say that our year of thinking is 2050. And I have not so much time to comment because there are lots of things. But among them, what is important is the question of demography and population distribution. In the neoliberal scenario, there is a growing of the Paris urban area and degrowth in the upstream of the basin. It is what we observe now, so it is just a confirmation of the of this trend. In the second one, Paris urban area is quite stable, but with the population growth that is predicted by our statistical agency is occurs upstream and downstream with a growing role of medium cities. This is the name of the scenario. And in the post-metropolitan one, what is very different is that there is a total reallocation of the population. So on the contrary to other scenarios, we don't kill people. We thought that it was not possible to do this. We had a lot of discussion about this because it is very complicated to think about this. But we imagined that this movement toward bioregionalism conducted to a reallocation of the population among the French and then European territory comprising migrants and so on. That is, in the Seine basin, there is a loss of population, a decreasing of the Paris urban region population, and a growing role of small towns and villages. I have already mentioned the political regime, and now I go more to the metabolism. Two things were very important in the thinking of the metabolism that are quite obvious, but I have to tell them. The first one is the arbitrage. Okay, between circularity and linearity, of course. And the second one that is very important is the difference between efficiency and sobriety. It is exactly what we have seen there. Of course, for the first scenario, what remains is a linear metabolism with some small cycles, small short supply chains, as we see now. But what we see now is that all those supply chains are dependent of the linear metabolism and are not able to change it. And if we go there, the metabolism becomes more circular, less intense to go to the post-metropolitan one. And then, in the same objective, here we have mainly efficiency, high-tech solutions, and we go there more sobriety when we go there the post-metropolitan scenario and there and towards the low-tech solutions. This is the same for land use, with here urban sprawl. Here, no net land loss, and even no land loss at all. And what is important for the last one is that we introduced deartificialization process, and even rewilding in some parts of the Seine basin. The diet, I have already mentioned it for the two first. For the first one, animal proteins are divided by three. And for the energy system, it is quite obvious, it is an optimized energy system with some renewable, but not so much. And you'll see here we are only renewable with possibly intermittent services. Show what it would be, we had some figures. So those maps that shows how they are very rough, but that show how urban population is distributing in the basin. But also some illustrations like this. This is the Champs-Élysées in the neoliberal scenario with La Défense. Here it is in Les Villes en leur bassin. You see that La Défense is the lowest and there is much more greenery. And this is Charles de Gaulle Airport, which has no more use, is useless, but it is also a place for urban mining, a very important place for urban mining, as other abandoned facilities, buildings, and so on. We also thought about the life of people. So we had several people we examined, and this is Rosie. It is our favorite one. That I mentioned Rosie. She is 13. In the neoliberal scenario, she lives in Marolles-en-Brie, which is in the Paris suburbs, quite a long way from the city center. And she, of course, I have given this to my children also, and I am really ashamed. But now. But she eats industrialized food. Her family are very car dependent, and they depend on traffic jams. And they have quite a lot of difficulties to pay for the fuel. So the father said, "No, we can't go to Disney this weekend because we have not enough money to pay for the entrance. Water is really very, very expensive," and so on. And in the other scenario, in Les Villes-en-Leur-Bassin, Rosie and her family have moved to Troyes, which is a city upstream from Paris, surrounded by forests. And there is a transformation of economy towards the use of local resources, and especially wood in several dimensions. And of course, now she has good organic food and so on. And this is the third scenario. So this is no more Rosie, this is Sarah. She is, I don't know the word in English, sage-femme?
Midwife.
Thank you. But what we imagined is that people, work does not exist anymore in this scenario, only activities. And people have multiple activities, sometimes the main one for which they are really trained. For a sage-femme, but there are also agricultural services because everybody has to contribute to food production. And she has not been selected by the random process to be at the assembly, local assembly, but if she had been selected, she would have spent a lot of time by discussing with the other people about decision making and so on. This has also metabolic results. So I just show the results for the last two scenarios, that is eco-socialist, Les Villes-en-Leur-Bassin, and municipalist, bioregional, post-metropolitan scenario. Those charts have been designed by Gilles Bilaine. And here you see nitrogen circulation. It is a little more precise than the previous one I have shown to you. What we can see that we have introduced something new is the recycling of urine and feces in this scenario. That is something very important, and all the more important when nitrogen flow decreases. I don't comment, it would be too long, but bloop. And this is in the post-metropolitan one. There are some differences between the two, and especially because of the diet. I have said that there are only twice less, third less animal proteins. But also, there is something new here. This is animal traction. That means that we need to grow animals in order to help transportation. So that explains the little difference in the flow charts. And this is, finished. This is energy. So we are not specialists of energy, so we used overworks. For the eco-socialist scenario, we used the negawatt scenario, which combines sobriety and efficiency, so that matches well with our scenario. And for the post-metropolitan one, we used the work of Willard Hopkins, Steinberger, and others, which is based on decent living conditions. That is quite low consumption rates, but with nice life, let's say. I think that our scenario has a lower level of consumption, but the principles are really similar, so it was a good base to use VAI figures in order to study our case. And, well, I don't have time to comment all this, but what shows this is that within the limits of the Seine Basin, we can provide all the food with a good safety margin in order to enhance exchange and solidarity with other places. And we can also provide the energy on the only renewable basis here and nearly only renewable basis here. And here we have, even if we have a renewable basis, we can introduce wilderness and so on. So it works. And to conclude, well, what we wanted to show there is the feasibility of those alternatives in terms of social change. Even the reaction to this is very diverse among our colleagues and partners and so on. But there is a feasibility on a social point of view and also on the biogeochemical energy point of view. If we want to think to the future, we have to take into consideration four sets of variables, at least: political organization, population distribution, socio-technical systems, and ecological characteristics, ecological variables. We want to emphasize the role of sobriety and to well discriminate between sobriety and efficiency. Of course, to do this, we have to think outside the conventional box and to admit, for instance, it was very difficult for some of us to admit that it is possible to decrease the farming, the area of farming land, or to admit political change. It has been quite interesting to discuss. So what are the impacts of our work? I think that all of us have changed, even the students. Some of them changed their vote for the presidential election in France. So it's a victory. And the reception of the scenario is very diverse. So some people say your third scenario is completely absurd and horrible, awful. This is absolutely what nobody wants. And the result is that they admit the middle one. It was not our aim, but it is very strange to see this. And now we are completing the work and preparing some booklets that could be used in several areas. And I just want to say a last thing, is that all this, which is very imperfect and has a lot of problems if you look in depth, but it takes time. I mean that you can't do this in 1 year. It is nearly 10 years of work. We don't do only this, of course, but you can't do this like that. Well, that's it. Thank you very much.